signal. So as I mentioned earlier, in the big picture, my guess is this. It's kind of a billiard, if you like, or this view flow of I don't know. You think back to your school physics and throwing a ball in the gravitational field. Gravitational in the gravitational field. That's really what it is. Where our instrument is then defining our lab coordinate system, our different components, define the devices or features that are in our instrument, so being sources and samples and monitors, etc. And then we transport neutron waves in that. So placing components in your instrument, we will typically start from placing the source. And the coordinate system definition there is that Z is our neutron propagation direction. So, yeah, it's a right-hand coordinate system, so better put the left one. Better put the left one in the pocket. So Z, the third finger, is along the beam, and Y is vertical, and X is then transverse horizontal to that. So if I'm the source and my pinhole is over there, that's what it would look like. And that's where you might remember a difference to the test, which has X, Y, Z, something like that, right? So that's a rotation in between the two. Yeah, so when you're constructing these instruments, you'll find yourself sitting like this a lot, especially if you are on a reactor source that has moving motors and things like that on the instruments. So that's quite normal. It means nothing. You're just thinking to move things in the right.
Yeah, I always confuse to switch coordinates from MacStas and Mantid.
It's the same. Yeah, it's the same. Yes. Yeah. Right. So what we typically do is replace the source, oftentimes directly at the origin. But it could also be, displaced from the origin. But certainly, with a fixed position to the origin typically. And then when we place the next object, it will be along then typically the Z direction. So in this case, I've put a guy at a meter from the source. And at encode, that will be at 0, 0, 1 relative to source. And that could have also been, this one I don't have that, but in principle, we could also say relative to previous, and then previous maps on to whatever the name of the array component is. Then you can specify rotations, of course. And what you should think of there is I move the object to a given position, and then I assume the orientation of another object. So actually, this need not be source here, which may be a little bit confusing. But so you place it at a point, you assume an orientation, and then you may rotate away from that. So in this case, you have another coordinate system, which is x, y, z, double prime up there, which is then rotated 30 degrees in plane here, around the vertical axis. What I should also remember to say here is that these rotations are applied in the order x, y, z, if you put multiple. But in a way, never mind, because you can decompose all you want. You can put an object called an arm, which is only a reference point, and this means that you can just do it in a different order and then refer to the earlier. You can do anything you like. So an important point here is that the coordinate system often starts at, let's say, the center of mass of the object, but not for the guides. For the guides, I place it here. It means it's kind of the beginning of the guide. And this means whenever you refer to the position of a guide, of course you have to refer to the beginning of the guide, and this means you'll have to put then the length of the guide in the app position in the subsequent subsequent element, otherwise they would overlap. But I mean, if you do this, it's no shame. Everybody did this this kind of error in the past, and everybody has to do that to get accustomed with the code. And the reason is that none of these components are really aware of each other. They are independent. They don't know nothing of each other than the app position. And then the McStas system takes care of the transformation between the local coordinate systems. Geometry-wise, in two dimensions, typically the shapes we have are rectangular or circular, and in three dimensions you can go to boxes or spheres or cylinders. And then we have a polygon description also that some components allow you to use, which is a description of the different vertices of an object and then the faces, meaning triangles basically, typically triangles, that together makes the outer shape of the object. The component classes is, I'm reiterating it again and again. So you have the sources that define the Monte Carlo starting conditions of the neutron, inject neutrons for the simulation. Optics used to tailor the properties of the neutron beam as we go along, mirrors, guides, choppers, carburetors, slits, matter in some shape or form. So there's a simple crystal up here. Monitors to probe the state of the neutron beam, install histograms or event lists, and then we have some other stuff in the miscellaneous category or obsolete, right? So the cassette tape there, it's kind of obsolete. So common to all components is that they either set or manipulate or interact with or measure the neutron rate, the state. So to describe that, we better start at the source. So as you know, moderators will basically, what is happening in there is a random walk. So to first order, these sources emit in 4 pi, and that's not so interesting if you want to go at the other end of the guide hole. So what you immediately do is you define a solid angle, which is your angle of interest. So in McStas, this is typically given by a distance along, typically along set, and then a rectangle of the width and height. So this could be the geometry of a beam point. And then what the source does is emit an intensity into that solid angle. So the unit of that to be thought of is basically the unit of the intensity out of the source is newtons per second per stadium, something like that. So what you do is immediately an integration over omega, basically. That takes out the stadium there. So the natural unit of intensity as we move through the McStas instrument is actually newtons per second. It doesn't mean that you couldn't have the installation source, that you couldn't normalize so it would be per pulse. But this is where some of our legacy comes in, so this was used by reactors first. So our natural unit of thinking is the notions per second. So that's the typical normalization unit. The intensity can of course then depend on wavelength, so it becomes a spectrum. It can have a time dependence. The time of flight source. It could even have a dependence on the local geometry of the source. So it could be that emission is different across the surface. And what we then do in McStas is that integrated intensity is partitioned over a set of rays. This is what we call the N count. And as Matt showed you before, the default is 10 to the 6 rays. And that basically means that this kind of sum here, that our sum of intensities of the individual rays here correspond to the integral of the intensity into the solid angle of omega over independence of the intensity, meaning the spectrum, meaning the pulse and the tail and everything. So that's important to bear in mind. The N count, that's just statistics. It's just statistics. If it becomes very low, it means that your convergence is probably poor. So you should do something to improve the statistics. But the real information, the physical information, that is called the intensity. That's the I in a moment. We'll come back to that in the next presentation as well in more detail. But it's often a question to me, what's important here? Is it the number of events, or is it this intensity? And the intensity is actually, in physical terms, the most meaningful one. Good. Yeah, so at the source, to define a new neutron, we have to identify the starting point at the source. So in the circular source, flat source, we have two random numbers that give us basically that two-dimensional position. Then we have to randomize towards the beam hole on the wall. We pick a vector that will take us that way. And together with a choice of energy or wavelength in the spectrum, this will then normalize our velocity vector. Then we pick a starting time. And then according to the spectrum and the time, etc., the weight is chosen. And if we do a polarized experiment, well, probably the source also has a polarization term, or maybe in a subsequent polarizer, you define polarization. Yeah, so S here kind of hints at spin, right? But don't think spin. There's no quantum mechanical spin in this, even though we actually kind of treat it as that when the lambda persists. We kind of do that, but don't think of it that way. It is a polarization. It is the expectation value of the polarization of the statistics which is included in this one ray. Okay. So let's sketch a simulation here. We start at the source. We have the blue neutron over there. And then we introduce a mirror. And what the mirror then does is request propagation of this neutron to the plane of the mirror. So that's the first thing that happens. We go to that plane. Then we do a check, typically. So we look, are we on the surface? Are we within the bounds of the mirror? And what's then the probability of reflection, etc.? And then we mirror that event. And of course the weight here is then adjusted according to the reflectivity of the mirror. And that would be according to, again we'll come back to the exact details of this, but of course we have super mirrors in here, so we have single layer nickel with a multi-layer on top. And we typically parameterize that in McStas by this kind of sketch of a function here. So we have a maximal reflectivity of R0. This goes out to QC of nickel here. And we have an M value out here, which is basically the inequality of the super mirror. Alpha gives you the slope of the top from nickel down to the lowest value, and then W here, that's basically the width of this kind of error function we have here. Goes from the maximum to the zero. So that's the parameterization of a mirror. And this means that basically the incoming weight is multiplied by whatever this function gives. Yeah, so the incoming neutron is parameterized in Q, we look up what should the value be, we multiply by the reflectivity, and then that's then the new green version of the neutron over here. Good. So in general, so what we just did, saw was kind of a special case, of course. In general, if you have the interaction between neutrons and matter. So we can think of the processes of being either absorbed or transmitted or scattered. And in McStas terms, at least for another thing sample, we will have macroscopic cross sections here that basically goes to the probability of being either absorbed or scattered or transmitted. And we define these the way that they together give a unity probability. So you can have one of these. And in the picture that basically in McStas, we never really physically, well, we do absorb neutrons, but what absorb means in McStas is more or less terminate the calculation. So absorption is typically encoded in the weight. So whenever we have one of the green neutrons here that are transmitted, we actually take into account the macroscopic cross section here. So instead of encoding this by, so that's again, going back to my first talk, talking about not transporting the individual neutrons, but instead doing what did I call it? Bias, what did I call that? Focusing? It's kind of, I can't remember what was my term. Never mind. But the idea is keep as much statistics as physically possible here. So encode absorption as a reduction of the weight rather than removal of the event. And this of course also goes for the scattered neutrons. So they are also in that sense a kind of beam, and we encode the absorption along the path of scattering in the sample. Yeah. Good. So moving as you just saw, basically moving from one component to the next in the instrument. Here's an incoming intensity, we multiply it by a weight, and that's then the outgoing intensity. And what we do is of course to select a weight that is physically meaningful. And it's also, you know, what the Carnot says, physically meaningful. So we have a kind of a variance reduction or biasing in there. So in one example is the powder component. You can choose which portion of the statistics that you keep in let's say a transmitted beam, which is only adjusted to the scattering and absorption, how much of the statistics you put onto the device shell cone, how much you put in the individual scattering. So at any point where it makes sense, we have this kind of biasing technique so that you may adjust what is your let's say your Monte Carlo branch of interest. So this you can do. And of course they have to fulfill that the sum of probabilities is unity. Right. So at the end, at the date component here, it's basically the multiplication of the weight factors of the preceding components that makes what our intensity is at. Right. So to first order, McStas is linear, and it simply follows the sequence of components you put in your instrument file. So you have on the screen you have two different formulations of the same instrument. One that, well, they both have the source at the very left. Then the one at the bottom here has a component here, and then the third one is here, and it's the opposite case up there. And this means that when we propagate to the first component in the list, this is where the neutron will be. And this means that you might have a complaint from in the top case, you might have a complaint from the third component that says, well, it's already gone. I don't know what's happening. I will just absorb that because that's probably not physically meaningful. So that is our default. That is actually to remove anything that has to travel back in time. There are ways to come around that if you know what you're doing. You can trick it to still do that, But generally speaking, you should organize your instrument with this kind of linear flow. For monitors, there's a special case. If you put restore neutron, it means that the monitor will propagate the neutron forward, it will do its measurement, and then politely they will put it back. So I touch nothing, so it's okay. So this kind of approach. So that's the main message here, that the order of the components is important. And in general terms, you should avoid overlaps of components. Right? And as I know, I didn't know exactly if it looks like all of you guys that used to run the tests also have some experience with MaxTest already, but just to outline the differences as I see them here, MaxTest is as much as we can SI, but of course with neutron scattering meaningful quantities by energies in milli-electron volts, wavelengths in angstroms, cross sections in bars. So VTES typically has centimeters for the distances. We have meters. So if you translate that geometry one to the other, bear in mind these two orders of magnitude in the length unit. And then the different coordinate system. So in MaxTest, Z is parallel to the beam, Y is vertical, X is orthogonal to the beam, and the horizontal plane. In VTES, it's actually X, Y, Z. That's the way it is. No, it's not. What is it? Yes, yeah, that's the way it is. Anyway, you'll find yourself doing like this. It's normal. Another difference is that MaxTest explicitly and also in a way automatically contains free space. In VTES, typically free space is actually kind of inside the component. So VTES propagates to the end, always. Whereas MaxTest just leaves it at the last point of scattering, or the last the emission position, maybe. And in the special case of sources, in VTES, the language, MaxTest always propagates by virtual window. So the default setting in VTES is actually by window or something like that. So it will actually propagate all the way to the entrance of the guide. At MaxTest, it's left at the source, and then it's the guide that takes care of the propagation for it. Yeah. So we have some compatibility features for the common use of MaxTest and VTES. The newest addition is something called MCPL. We'll come back to what this is. It's a particle list format, that's what I can say about it here. It's supported since 2016 in MaxTest version 2.3. And in this came in VTES in the last version from late 2018. So in the past we also had components called VTES output and VTES input in MaxTest. These things probably better use MCPL, which is a standard format that is also coming in rest tracks. We have solutions for MCMP and CHAMP4 and other things. So if you need to solve special cases of your transport in certain codes, we have a way to do that. We also have a semi-automatic tool called MaxTest 2 VTES. So if you have an instrument on plane VTES and you need to enrich that with a single MaxTest component, there's an automated way of putting one MaxTest component in VTES.
I would like to refer VTES to MaxTest.
Yeah, sure. But just to show that that actually we've had quite a lot of collaboration with VTES and Klaus Leutner. And if there's competition, it's a friendly competition. So for instance, he worked with MaxTest for 2 years in the past. Yeah. Anyway, I think that was it.